One of the incredible people I was fortunate to meet, first as a student and then as a faculty member of Singularity University, is Tasha McCauley, who's here today, who will be talking about her dedication to fellow robots. Please welcome Tasha McCauley.
I was working at Singularity University. I was on the faculty there. I was directing the Autodesk Innovation Lab, which is a really fun lab where we teach students about robotics and AI and nanotech and biotech, and they can get in there and get their hands on some robots and 3D printers. It's a lot of fun. And one of my colleagues, Dan Barry, and I were working on some robotics projects. And at the very beginning of the summer was just kicking off, 80 new students had arrived. One of the co-founders, Peter, called us up and he said, "Guys, I really want to be there. I want to come meet all those students. I want to be able to go to some classes. I want to go to some parties, but I can't because my twin babies were born yesterday. I have to stay here in LA. Do you think you could buy me a telepresence robot?" Well, for those of you who don't know what a telepresence robot is, it's in its most elemental form, it's just video chat on wheels. You Skype into it, your face will appear on the screen, and you can drive around from wherever you are in the world. So I could be in Paris, and I have a colleague in New York, and I want to go to some business meetings, I want to hang out at that office. I can go as a robot. And so we took a look around for Peter. We saw, you know, we went to look at what was available on the market, and there wasn't that much at the time. There was, you know, one telepresence robot we were looking at, it was about $15,000, and we weren't about to spend that money. So we called Peter back, and we said, "Sorry, can't buy you one. Maybe we could build you one." So Dan and our coworker James and I, we trucked it over to the local machine shop by way of the electronics store and the hardware store. And we spent the next 8 hours building a telepresence robot. And the next day, Peter was able to Skype in, and he went to a couple classes. He hung out with all the students, and he had a blast. He went to a party, and we were very excited. His twin babies even Skyped in for a little while. And this was a great experience for us. It taught us a lot. And I'll come back to that a little bit. I'm just going to give you an overview of what I'm going to talk to you about. You've sort of seen what a telepresence robot is. I'm going to talk to you about why we need telepresence robots and how we're going about building them, and then a little bit about our vision for the future. So why we need them. They're going to change every field I can think of. They're definitely going to change healthcare. They're going to change how we, you know, care for our elderly, how we deal with security, and how we do business in general. They're going to improve the fidelity of communication. If you think about how we communicate now in the digital age, we've got, you know, on one end of the spectrum, we've got really, really narrow bandwidth, sort of single sensory channel communication, texting and emailing, you know, where you really can't get a lot of info from the person. You can just see the plain message. You don't get vocal intonation and you don't get facial expressions. On the other end of the spectrum, you've got being there with somebody, being there in person, and you get so much more information. And then there are a whole bunch of other ways of communicating along the way. There's telephone, so you get some more info. And then video chat came along, and that was huge for people because you can see somebody's facial expression. You can hear what they sound like. Telepresence robots is even closer because you get spatial orientation. You can hang out with that person in their context. And you can respond to stimuli in your environment, turn and talk to multiple people. So that's really powerful. But there are still limitations. You're still not there. And that brings me to talk about, you know, how do we compensate for that? And what are we going to do as a company in terms of building telepresence robots that really get you there? So any telepresence robot company, you know, has robots that are mobile. And mobility is so powerful in and of itself. That's a worthwhile endeavor. That's the kind of thing where you're putting computing, you know, taking a computer and making it mobile. You're giving, you know, positional autonomy to a remote person. That's great. But that wasn't quite enough for us. We thought, you know, what can we do to bring you even closer to the in-person experience? We thought back to our very first robot that we built, and we took a real lesson from that. That was so special. We were looking at other companies, and they were, you know, having these two-year development timelines. And in 8 hours, we just slapped something together that totally worked, and it had most of the functionality of any telepresence robot you would buy. That was really incredible to us because we were paying attention to the power of exponential technologies. We were saying, you know, there were things that weren't available to us 6 months ago, even a week ago, that were available that day. The Samsung Galaxy tablet, which was the thing that we used, you know, the screen that we used on our bot, had a forward and rear-facing camera. And it had, you know, you could Skype into it, and that was not available 3 days before this project, you know? That was incredible to us. We used a Samsung Galaxy tablet, a Roomba, basically a vacuum. Without a vacuum in it, that same company made a version of the Roomba that was just a programmable robot. We took that and, you know, some aluminum bars. And actually, there was an Android-based app as well that was like a virtual joystick and that enabled us to drive the robot. And bam, we had a telepresence robot. I mean, it was simple. It was just a pole on a stick with a screen and a lampshade over the Roomba. I mean, I literally took the lampshade to the machine shop and, like, you know, milled a hole in it. That was really fun. So, but that experience really brought us something. I mean, you can see all these different iterations. I built one out of, you know, cardboard and metal, and I mean, gosh, it was a pretty fun little project. But that lesson really taught us something. It taught us to think about modularity and to think about, ask the question, how do we build this architecture for maximum flexibility to track the downward pricing of these components? That's really important because, you know, you don't build a computer from scratch. You start with sort of a design requirement and you work backward from there. And what we wanted was something where you could look at the price point and the performance of every single component all the time and be optimizing each part. And that gives you this sort of constant evolution of your product. And it's like, as one of my team member says, Neil Jacobstein, he says, you know, it's doing for molecules what object-oriented programming did for bits. If there are any programmers out here, you know, it's basically just taking each component and making it its own piece. Imagine if you could do this for your car. I think about my car, I've got a 10-year-old GPS system in there. The hardware is kind of hard to navigate and it's clunky and I don't use it anymore. What I do is I punch the destination in on my iPhone and I use the screen as a placeholder for my iPhone, you know? That's not modular. You can't update that real time. That's, you know, it's stuck. And we don't want our robots to be that way. So we're really focusing on this highly flexible and agile hardware setup. And that brings me to the next question, which is, what is it about this, what is it about being there in person that's so valuable? What are we lacking by not being there in person? Well, we're lacking senses, right? When we're in a telepresence robot, we've got visual and audio, you know, and sort of auditory information coming at us, and we've got some spatial information, but we don't get touch, we don't get taste and smell, other things that give us the quality of just being there. And we thought, what can we do about that? Well, you're in a robot. I mean, you've got the power to turn it into your superhuman avatar. Why not give it any sensor that exists? This is the power of having this modular infrastructure because you can add sensors at will. So we thought, what if somebody, you know, wants to be able to conduct searches and they want infrared on their bot? What if somebody wants to know if you're nervous and they want pupil dilation sensors? What if you are a doctor and you want a heart rate sensor on your robot? What if you just want eyes in the back of your head? You want a forward and rear-facing camera so you can see both views at once? I mean, these are things that you can't do as a biological person. So we thought, it's great. Use the robot, despite its limitations, to give people powers that they wouldn't normally have so that they want to use a robot. And that's a really, really fun thought for us, and that's really extending off of this idea of modular architecture. Just plug in what you need. This leads us to sort of the final piece of this puzzle, which is it's all open source hardware and software, and we're building what's basically an app store where developers can develop applications to handle these customized sensor sets. So if you know, choose the sets of sensors that you want, and you can write an app for it to handle it in any kind of way that you want, or if you don't know how to write an app for it, send a request out to the community, and other people will write apps for it. And then they may think of solutions that you didn't even think of. And this really leads me to an interesting thought about this. These are some just, you know, so you can see what our robot is shaping up like. These are some images of our first robot that we're putting out this summer. And it's got some little arms there. Those are actually a pop-up hanger that you can clip on, because people kept wanting to put a t-shirt on their robot. I mean, everybody wants that. It's really funny. So then this sort of gives you just an idea of what the shape of our robot is. This is our tablet-based, you know, very portable robot. And actually, the next version of our robot is going to be the one that really has like all the sensor ports. And the reason this is so powerful, one of the mentors of my life, a computer scientist named Alan Kay, says point of view is worth 80 IQ points. And I completely believe that. The more different ways you can look at something, the more different people you can have look at something, the better solutions you're going to come up with, and the wider variety of solutions you're going to come up with. So if we've got this open platform where everybody's developing custom applications for custom sensor sets, we're going to discover use cases we would never have thought of. We're going to discover ways of using a robot that we would never have thought of, and that's so exciting. I was thinking about this with a friend of mine who's just an inspiring person in every way. He's a Canadian, he's an athlete, and he recently competed at the 2012 London Games. And I had a talk with him about using this robot, and he's been very interested in telepresence robots. And I'll show you a little bit about him so you can get an idea of who he is and why he's interested in this.
When my mom came out of her cesarean delivery of me, she was still kind of sedated, and she asked the nurse, oh, is it a boy? And the nurse said, yes. And then my mom asked, does he have any hair? And the nurse said, oh, I don't really know. I guess she was preoccupied with some of my other features, huh? You know, being born without arms and legs really could have shattered my life. It would have been a great excuse for me not to try, not to excel. But lucky for me, right from the beginning, my parents treated me as if I would succeed. They treated me, I'll say, like a normal child. I'm an international athlete, so I compete on the national bocce team. And sport has given me many, many opportunities off of the field of play as well. I've made the conscious decision to put myself in an environment where I will excel. So I chose to become an international athlete. I chose to go to university, and I'm choosing to become a lawyer, a very competitive and adversarial profession.
The first time I was introduced to the concept of telepresence robots, it was in the context of going to a museum with your family. So your family's in another city on the other side of the world, and you dial into one of these robots that you can control and go around and see everything in the Louvre. And I thought that was so cool. But then I started thinking about my own context, and I realized, what are the emotional consequences of dialing in and controlling a robot avatar? A lot of times people use the phrase confined to a wheelchair, and I could see maybe that same type of phrasing being used with telepresence robotics, confined to a robot. But wheelchairs are not confining, they're empowering. They allow us to go out and do what we need to do in the world. And, you know, telepresence robots would be equally empowering to someone who can't be somewhere for financial or physical reasons.
J'imagine aussi qu'un jour, probablement, la téléprésence des robots pourrait faire de la traduction instantanée, et ça serait vraiment génial.
So Josh is a perfect example of somebody that we want using our robot. Not only are we going to be able to, you know, not only is he going to find ways to use our robot, and you know, he's got an experience that most of us don't have. He's going to totally come up with ideas that we wouldn't have thought of. But he's also going to feed back to us, you know, how can we build a better robot, and how can we improve this? And through that open architecture that we're talking about, we're really seeking information from people like Josh and from all different minds. And, you know, even the mentor of my mentor, Alan Kay, says something similar, which is, you haven't understood something until you've understood it more than one way. And this is really key and core to our philosophy. And I think it's gonna do a lot for the future of telepresence robots. And I think we're gonna learn a lot about this field by opening it up like this. Thank you so much.